She's June in the book. So. It's very autobiographical.
Yes, yes.
Except that I never killed anyone. With the bow and arrow.
Not yet.
Yeah.
Not yet.
Not yet. Thank you, Johnny.
Okay, thanks. Thanks.
We don't want it to get into the show.
All right. Nope, we're all set.
Thank you.
All right.
I'll move it.
Nope. Yeah, everybody's doing great.
One night.
Yeah.
I don't know why I carry so much, but I think I need everything.
All right. Got a kind of a full house. I'm so excited. So my name is Christina Goodwin. I know most of you, and I met you for the first time. So today, I'm really excited for you guys to be here and to hear my mother's incredible book, Holy Days, which she self-published early this year, right?
April.
There you go. So it's feels like we just did it.
Yeah,
we've
really.
Done so much
I know.
With it. We've done so much. So anyway, so and also special thanks to Worktable. This is a co-working space here in Marblehead. And so if you guys haven't been here before, there's a restroom in the back. And just so you know, we have some wine and cheese over there. And so we're just so excited to do the reading in this space. And people might be coming and going, so we just kind of be fluid with the chairs and whatnot. But I think we should have plenty of space for everybody to join.
Yeah.
The more the merrier. Let's see, and then the books are going to be for sale for $10, so you know, definitely be enjoying sharing those with you after the reading. And of course, there'll be the reading and then Q&A. But before the reading, I definitely want to introduce our dear friend Dan Zampino, who's going to do a lovely introduction for my mom. So, Dan.
This is a real honor to be asked to do this. I've known Patricia for about 20 years.
Yeah, it's been a while.
And what has always been amazing, I've read a number of her stories, as well as her poems, and we've had the opportunity to have her perform many of those poems when Angela and I ran the open mic down at the Hoover Mansion for 10 years, and we got to see her evolve her poems in many ways. She's written, she wrote a remarkable book of poetry based upon the idea that America is Atlantis. Perhaps we're in our last days if we don't become aware of what we're doing. And she integrates celebrity culture with lyricism in a way that is quite remarkable. She also wrote a telling book about the murders of two women, one in the 1690s and another around the year 1991, happening to be the year that Angela and I moved here. So she wrote a stunning book that was sort of a parallel of two historical events, and she has a gifted sense of dialogue and a wonderful sense of history. In this book, she takes on two subjects, one of which is near and dear to me, which is ethnic literature, since she and I share a similar ethnic background, but also she goes into the darker side of family malevolence. And I just find that to be an extraordinary parallel. I think that this book deserves wider readership, and I'm honored to introduce Patricia Goodwin.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. It's all my favorite people are in the room, and I might cry. So, keep the specs. This is Holy Days, and this is me when I was 3 years old, wondering if this was going to be okay, you know, me stepping out there on the porch. Basically, it's been a journey, you know, in Holy Days. Okay, sorry, excuse me. It started, of course, when the picture was taken, and sometimes I really do think when I look at the book that was the beginning of the whole story. But when I was a student at Salem State, I was driving home and I was stopped at a red light at the Glover School. I saw all the children running down the hill. I was probably about 20. And I thought, wouldn't it be great to be waiting at the bottom of that hill for a child coming out of that school? And so I created this dream to be a writer living in Marblehead, married to an artist who's also a writer, and have an artist child. And Holy Days is the culmination of that dream, and it's the story of my journey. want to thank my friends and family who believed in me, Jody, Judy, Tim and Christina, who've made the dream a reality and reality a dream. I also want to thank Dan and Angela and Lee, of course, and Kristen, who's been an amazing spirit in my life. Thanks also to Ziggy Hartfelder, the Irish photographer from Salem. She's not here tonight, but she begged me for years to show Holy Days to her friend, Michael Patrick McDonald, who's the author of All Souls and Easter Rising. Holy Days was finished in 1996 and made the rounds to every known publisher and agent. Finally, in 2007, Michael agreed to read 8 pages. I'll be reading that chapter tonight. It's very representative of the book. On Easter Sunday in 2008, I got his email, and this is what he said. The narrative is incredible. Your narrative style, meticulous, superb. It's a remarkable story, and your writing is a pleasure to read, even through some tough situations. I think it is going to be a brilliant book. Of course, his agent rejected it for the second time. The first time, years earlier, it was hard copy. I was taking a nap when I heard something very heavy hit the storm door. I said, I think I know what that is. But for many years now in publishing, the subject of incest has become a taboo for a different reason. Publishers are actually bored with it. They've become so jaded, they really think people don't want to hear about it. But in fact, our human stories are very limited. Boy meets girl, you know, war stories, different kinds of success stories, suffering of like famine, etc., escape stories. These are all very basic things that we never tire of. So I really disagree with them heartily, and I think there's the main reason, of course, is that there are children out there right now, even as we speak, who are suffering, and the story needs to be told. The title Holy Days is not a Catholic title. Holy Days comes from the holiness of life. Holy Days is part portrait of the artist as a young girl, part Colette's earthly paradise, part the diaries of Anaïs Nin. The earthy as spiritual, food as orgasmic, days of wonder and love, as well as terror and confusion. I wrote Holy Days for the victims, to describe the Stockholm syndrome of life as a child. And an abused child, of course, the Stockholm syndrome becomes even more intense. To tell the truth about what happened, what it felt like, the terrors, the dreams, even the pleasure. Facing the truth is the only way to make it bearable and to give justice to the victims. And all of it is holy because it makes us who we are. I'm going to read a short chapter called Bettina and Susie about a visit from Gloria's lesbian great aunt and her girlfriend, who were what was called and was still called butch femme, very overtly gay during a time when walking down the street was dangerous, and as we know, for gays, and as we know, it still is. Gloria is about 12. Her father's name is Billy Wisher, her mother, Rosie. Jakey, her brother, and his friend Rick walk in near the end of the chapter. I also want to read a quick review from a reader. It was fantastic. It brought up so much of my own stuff that it left me reeling for a while, but it is also so exquisite. Holy Days. Forgive me. I ask this of all the children who were shot or beaten, raped, murdered, burned, mutilated, stuffed in trash bags, buried or left for dead by the side of the road, by their fathers or mothers, step-parents, friends, strangers, priests, Nazis, I don't know which of them is the worst. Forgive me. For the rest of my life, I'll know it was nothing, nothing compared to what other children suffered. Still, it changed me forever. But that's not all that worked on me. Worked and worked, trying to kill me, to smother me with its heavy chest, to choke me with its adult penis. The street worked on me, and the city, the men and the women and their children worked. There was a lot of work to be done. They tried to kill me in this place of love and horror. They tried to kill me, but they couldn't, because I loved too much. I could not be killed, though they did not know that yet. I loved them all in their beauty and in their ugliness. I even began to love the pain they inflicted upon me as my companion, as myself. I began to love the noise and the screams, the barreling of the trucks and the whine of the sirens, the smell of horseshit in the air, sweet as grass, and the sweet, sweet blossoms of the pear tree. They couldn't kill me with these things, though they tried. To the old Italians who taught me how to love, to Mr. George Doucette, who taught me how to read literature and saved my life. It's Joan, my angel. Excuse me. Every day is a holy day. Gloria Wishmer. Tina and Susie. In the home, Daddy was saying, his voice cracked with sobs. They never let us. Take it easy, Billy, consoled my mother's aunt Bettina. Her deep voice, that's all over now. You've got a nice family now and a nice home. You made it out of there, right? With her own strong grip, she held his trembling hand across the kitchen table. He didn't often do that, break down about the home in which he'd spent much of his childhood. But occasionally, if the conversation hit a nerve, he crumbled. They'd been talking about my reading at the dinner table, how I always had a book, and whether or not it was a good thing. Daddy broke down because the priests wouldn't let them read books. If they were caught doing nothing, as the priests called it, they'd be given work to do, like scrubbing the toilets or the long staircase in the rectory. Aunt Bettina had a voice as deep and gruff as a man's could be. She fooled me every time she called on the phone. Rosie there? She asked in a playful tone of a man who was strange to me, but who seemed to know Ma secretly and very well. My back went up like a little porcupine. Who was this guy who thought he could talk to my mother like he was her boyfriend? Annoyed, I handed Ma the receiver. It's a man, I said disapprovingly. She looked quizzical. Her insurance broker? A salesman? I could hear the male voice laughing, deep and loving, echoing along the little space between Ma's ear and mine. It's a man, Rosie. It's a man, Bettina teased. Ma laughed, looking my way and shaking her head. It's your Aunt Betty, you stupid, she said affectionately. We were supposed to call her Aunt Betty, but I couldn't resist calling her Aunt Bettina, which was a much prettier name. She was a small woman who wore her thick brown hair short and combed straight back from her noble forehead. She smoked more cigarettes than Daddy. When she visited Ma, she drank Lipton tea, but I always envisioned a heavy-set glass of whiskey rather than Ma's crockery mug with the tea bag's delicate string and label dangling out that seemed so fragile in front of her square body. Aunt Bettina was Grandma's sister, but our family was the only one who would receive her. She came always with her girlfriend Susie, who called her Tina in a secret pet way, which was lovely to hear. Susie had pressed gold hair that she wore in the style of the glamorous movie stars of the 30s, like Carol Lombard or Betty Davis, in permanent waves cascading close to her skull. She held her neat golden head very erect upon her tall, thin frame, like a ballet dancer. Tina and Susie had to have a reason for coming, usually to do something for Ma. Maybe that was their way of rationalizing this risk to Ma's standing in the family. Ma just smiled her Mona Lisa smile and said she didn't care. I had no idea why Aunt Bettina wasn't welcome at Grandma's house. Grandma, who was the most generous person I knew. But the only thing different about Aunt Bettina was her voice and her hair, So I assume that whatever these were clues of, that was the reason. This reason floated above Bettina and Susie like, curiously enough, halos, since it seemed to single them out for a perverse kind of sainthood. In fact, there was something uncannily sweet and fine about Bettina and Susie. Bettina and Susie. Why do some names ring out like the bells of heaven and others like the tolls of hell? Bettina and Susie, two saints, two angels, kicked out of the church, but I was sure not out of heaven. On this night, Susie stood and retouched Ma's hair with Blondex while everyone talked. I was reading Dickens, real reading, not for school. I always read every book the author had written, not just what I had to read for school. Real reading, sometimes called sacred reading, was a theme song of mine. Ma sat without her glasses, her beautiful eyes puffy from the shampoo, a towel spread over her shoulders, the squirmy terrier in her lap. Susie called Tarotin La Pichazza in bastardized Italian, the little pisser. Ma handed Susie bobby pins as Susie sectioned the wet, dark red hair, spun the ribbons of hair on her finger, and pinned them in little circles against Ma's head. Till Ma's hair disappeared and she was wearing a bathing cap of tight red spirals. Daddy sat with us, which was a phenomenon, a tribute to Aunt Bettina, really. He kept trying to give her a little shot with her tea. They were asking me about the fine print and the thin pages in my book. Look at the pages, so thin, like the Bible. How the hell can you see those words, Gloria? You're gonna ruin your eyes. Billy, you should get her a magnifying glass, no shit. Daddy laughed, kind of proud of me. Oh, she loves that stuff. The smaller the print, the thinner the paper, the better. What's that, Shakespeare? Dickens. I called all the books by their authors now, no matter what the title. They were Dickens or Collins or James. Oh, he said, like he knew. She should be a teacher, Aunt Bettina advised. Susie agreed. She nodded, bobby pins jammed in her mouth. I'm going to be a writer, I said. Susie murmured, impressed. A what? Like what, for the newspaper? Aunt Bettina growled. No, like for books. That's no good. Be a teacher. You get your summers off. Everyone agreed. I could travel, they said. I'd get paid for my summers and have them off, too. She's always reading, Ma told them. Oh, yeah? You should be a teacher, then. She even brings books to the table. I have to tell her every night, no reading at the table, Ma said proudly, handing Susie another bobby pin for her mouth. Oh, that's no good. You shouldn't read at the table, Aunt Bettina told me. I can't stop, I said. That's when we noticed Daddy's eyes had gone all red and the tears started to drop one by one on the table. He sniffed and Aunt Bettina asked him what was wrong. He told us about the orphanage. Things leaked out from time to time about his past. Things leaked, just like his tears, one by one, and fell before us. I still didn't know everything I should about my father's life, all the mysteries, all the reasons, but I couldn't stand to see him cry. My stomach hurt, as though someone powerful had grabbed it full in his fist and twisted it mercilessly. Tears gathered in my own eyes. Susie looked pained, and Ma looked down at the pins held tightly in her red-tipped fingers. I keep having this dream, I said quietly. They all looked at me. What, like Martin Luther King? Aunt Bettina joked, and uncomfortably trying to break the tension. I smiled, kinda. The communists come marching down the street, right down Hitchborn, with tanks and soldiers doing that step. What is it? The goose step, Daddy sniffed. Yeah, the goose step. I could see them and hear their feet coming right down our street where we used to play, and I'm terrified. Next thing I know, they're storming up the steps to my room. They make so much noise it scares me to death. They have guns with bayonets and big boots and helmets like the Nazis. I keep getting them mixed up with the Nazis. They start tearing the books off my shelves, and they're going to arrest me and take the books away and burn them. And one of the books they take is the Diary of Anne Frank. And in my dream, I walk right up to the leader, the sergeant, or whatever he is, and I say, you can't take them from me. I've already read them. They were silent a minute, then Aunt Bettina said, you should come down and talk more often, Gloria. It was true. I never came down from my room. I'd created another world up there with my books and my heroes. But I made a special effort this night because Bettina and Susie had brought me clothes, beautiful clothes. Bettina's old cashmere sweaters that had a faint odor coating dry cleaning, which clung to my hands like a film of oldness after touching the soft, cushy fabric, but I didn't mind. The colors were deep blues and greens, the colors of the sea and forest, and no one had ever given me anything so fine. There was also a fuchsia wool jacket of impeccable tailoring. Not that I would have known what such a thing as impeccable tailoring was, I just knew it when I saw it. The jacket had short sleeves, and I marveled that a woman could be cool enough to need a jacket, but warm enough to not need sleeves. It was then that Jakey walked in the back door with Rick right behind him. "Where are you coming from?" Daddy asked Jakey. Jakey shrugged, "Nowheres." Aunt Bettina studied them both. Susie went on with Ma's hair as though she had no need to study them. She already knew what she'd find. "Clean your feet," Ma hollered, but they were already on their way upstairs. As he passed me, Rick mumbled, "Body by Fisher," and Dad's head jerked around in my direction. "What'd he say?" "I don't know," I lied. It was from a car commercial, something about the sleek lines of the car. Earl Rizzo had started calling me that. "He's a little scumbag, huh?" Aunt Bettina asked Daddy. Daddy polished off the dregs of his beer. "You said it," he agreed. "What the hell happened to his face?" she asked. There was an awkward silence for a minute while we waited for each other to answer her. "He was hit by a truck when he was little," I said. "Jesus. Want some more tea, Betty?" Mara asked her. "Sure, Rosie. Can I interest you in a wee drop of the creature, Betty?" Daddy teased with a mock Irish brogue. It was amazing how quickly and how often my loyalty shifted. How war wasn't as simple as it should be. It was more like the stories people tell afterwards, as when a prisoner actually has to live with the enemy, and the enemy takes care of him, nurses him back to health, and finally hides him from his own side and helps him to escape. There was never a time when I could forget, never a time when I could believe that Daddy was my father. At times he was the enemy and I was his prisoner, and at other times I was caring for him and hiding him. Sorry we were enemies. Never did I plan his escape. No, in fact, I was sure I should kill him. If I were honorable and brave, I would have killed him by now. No hero would have eaten his food or drunk with him at his table. I should have run through with my sword a long time ago. That much was clear. What was not clear was why his tears cut through me like a sword. Why it made me proud sometimes to think of him. Why it repulsed me right now to watch him getting another drink and absentmindedly scratching one foot with the rough, peeling skin of the other. Why I let Rick talk to me like that. Why I was proud to have him think I had a body by Fisher. Why I was proud that he'd been hit by a truck and was so tough, he was still walking around. I should kill them both. I should kill them. Why didn't I?